Let's get started. And we're talking, of course, about male violence against women, and I'm really specifically naming it. And in the US and in Canada, there's a lot of the abbreviation of VAW, violence against women. All these years I thought, well, that really names it. But no, it's male violence against women that we are talking about. Before we do, we're talking about women, we have to talk a little bit about gender. And so I'd like to, and I will be doing a little up and down with catching the video. So I'd like to have a listen to a song by Dar Williams, When I Was a Boy.
I won't forget when Peter Pan came to my house, took my hand, I said I was a boy, I'm glad he didn't. Check. I learned to fly, I learned to fight, I lived a whole life in one night. We saved each other's lives all on the pirate deck. And I remember that night when leaving a late night with some friends, and I hear somebody tell me it's not safe, someone should help me. I need to find a nice man to walk me home when I was a boy.
Anything that struck you when you were listening to that song? Either a personal experience or... I'll start off. I liked when she talked about less is more and more is less, and she's talking about now she's got to dress up and all of a sudden it restricts what she does and she's changed. What she's had to do.
She painted a really interesting picture of what it would feel like to be a boy. Like there was freedom, and it was like could do whatever I wanted, and I didn't have to wait for somebody to walk me home. And it seemed like really, it just made me wonder, wow, it's like so much better, you know? It just, the way she was painting it was so liberating.
Mm-hmm. And it's funny, I think about also, she was describing what people would call a tomboy, and certainly that was my experience growing up, that I was a tomboy, but actually, you know what? Majority of us were tomboys. That wasn't the abnormal. We were like that. And then our lives, in some ways, got restricted. But what about what she had to say about the man she was talking to? When he said, well, I was a girl.
Yeah, I really like how it kind of illustrates how these traditional gender roles really hurt men too, mm-hmm. and really restrict them from pleasures of life and a lot of really rich experiences like it does for women.
Mm-hmm. I really liked the line that said, I could always cry, now when I'm alone I seldom do, because it showed like the idea that men are having to constantly be masculine and tough, and how like the freedom to cry is just something that we all mm-hmm. deserve.
Yeah, and that line struck me too, because it's not only culture or sociocultural things that are constraining him, it's himself now. He mm-hmm. censors himself. And we all sort of grew up in this culture and are censoring ourselves. We, you know, the society may have started it, but we're sort of involved in it too. But I did want to move on about this, but I want to talk about, so in this culture, we do divide the world into two distinct categories, male and female. And of course, we know now, much better understanding, that gender is a spectrum, there's diversity, but the way our culture treats it and talks about it is as if there's only just men and only just women. So we'll look at that and the impact of that, but not disregarding the fact that there is this whole spectrum. But it not only divides into two camps, but then a large portion of the one camp, the female camp, gets a lot of negative things that are associated. Men do have some things and prices they pay, but we're gonna look at the violence that women experience as part of that as well. Keeping in mind as we talk about this, that you know, the world talks about big categories of men and women and how they're distinct and separate, Mars and Venus, but more women are like men than not like men, and more women have different experiences amongst themselves because of where they are. And that can be lots of different sort of social locations. We can't talk about gender without talking about all the other parts that go in it. So I've listed a bunch there. Have I left anything out? So race and ethnicity, nation of origin, indigenous identity, sexual orientation, gender identity. Anything that I should have put in there that I forgot? There's a lot. Did I put ability? I think I did. Yeah. Oh, that's good. Probably didn't. I purposely left out just to get us started. Didn't talk about immigration status, mm-hmm. documented and undocumented. Quebec, you can't talk about diversity without talking about language. But there's other things. How many of you are from small towns? How many from big towns? Pardon me?
Middle towns.
A middle town. And so I've been in small and little. So there are lots of things, lots of diversity. So again, as we go today, leaving the door open for discussion about where that takes us. And some things may be obvious. Some of our social locations are maybe obvious, and some may not be at all. I think Quebec's always interesting because language is not always so obvious. It's not such a visible difference, but there are ones that are, and there we may assume, wow, I have a lot in common with you, and then as we get to chat, say, maybe we have something in difference too. Let's talk a little bit about the word rape culture. I would like to show a music video by Lady Gaga, Till It Happens to You. So just to get us thinking about the idea of rape culture, I have two options for you. The first is from the movie, and it has more explicit, unsettling, emotionally strong, powerful images. So I want to give you the choice of that or the other, which is her performing at the Oscars. There are good things in both of them. We'll miss something in choosing one. But I just wanted to ask, which would you be more comfortable watching? Are you okay with the first one, or should we go with the one just of her performance?
I think that's fine.
Mm-hmm. So much all in that one video. It has an awful lot to say. What were some of the things that struck you?
For me, the first time I had seen that video, I was definitely, it was the graphic scenes that really impacted me, and coming at it now, it was nice to have the scenes of support stand out more, and I think it took a few times watching it to focus on that side of it. Yeah.
The flashback scenes, you can't ever get away from it. It's like with you for as long as you live.
Mm-hmm.
It's a huge scar.
It struck me also, this time even more for some reason, maybe because I've seen it enough times now, the message is on the arm. And it seems like it's so hard so easy for women to understand why at first we're writing, I am worthless, I hate myself, etc. Sometimes men have troubles understanding that, but then for me that positive of moving to the armed message that said I'm worthy, listen, believe me, and those kinds of things. What is it about our culture that an automatic response is for women to say those negative things, you know, which we don't say when we're getting mugged.
Something I found poignant about that was the was how the victims were all in different situations, and there was a diversity there, and that it doesn't matter what kind of situation you're in, that these things still happen to all types of people.
Mm-hmm. And then at the end, I'd forgotten that there were even stats. You know, I was like, that's quite a stat. You know, 1 out of 5, if this year.
I was like, what stood out for me a lot as well was when the believe me message came on, the music kind of pauses or like comes to like a stop. And I thought that was just really powerful. When she sings Till Your World Burns and Crashes, really like you could see how consuming like that it was for all of them, and how they couldn't concentrate on anything else after, and it's just, yeah.
Well, it still happens, that believe me. It's still, just a few weeks ago, we did something with in the States was, you know, high up people too.
Yeah.
Not being believed, it's like, it's so ridiculous.
Yeah, and when you think about it, I was sort of riveted, it's like watching a car crash on the highway, you just can't stop looking. This woman who was so, everybody, no matter what their stripes, what their political background was saying she was so credible. And what she had to do to be so credible. And yet, it didn't matter. Mm-hmm. That's the hard one. It's like, if somebody that credible, it doesn't make a difference. And, you know, I get sometimes discouraged because they were talking about, well, you know, women are learning to come and step forward and speak out. Well, women are still learning, it doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. It doesn't make a difference.
Mm-hmm. And relating that to the stats at the end, you think if it's 1 in 5 college women, what are the stats and people for people with, you know, in a lower socioeconomic bracket? Are they higher? You know, what are we, and how are they going to be believed?
Mm-hmm.
It's like the point everyone made in the Kavanaugh trial. If Dr. Ford, rich white lady, cannot be believed,
mm-hmm.
where does that leave the rest?
Yeah. And it took a while for them to start calling her Dr. Ford. At first it was, you know, so it goes to something in our culture. And also I just wrote down the first thing I when I saw that, like, how do we get to a point where a guy thinks it's okay to put drugs in a drink? It's like, it's so horrible. It's
so
not even just like I was out of control with my emotions. It's like, oh, premeditated planning, kind of.
It's kind of normalized, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And with the talk of people not being believed, especially when they come out years after, and, you know, a lot of people will say, oh, why didn't they come out before? Why did it take years? And what people don't understand about this thing is, like, you know, you suppress for so long, you don't understand what happens, and it's, you know, when so many people aren't believed, it's hard to come forward, because we have so many cases, like the Kavanaugh situation, where, like,
mm-hmm.
he still gets to go live his life and in that position of power. And, like, a huge reason why a lot of women come out so many years later is because, in this case, like, once the person who assaulted you is going in a position of power, like, you're naturally going to be triggered by that, and you're going to not want them to be in a position where they have so much of this power.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, power is huge. Mm-hmm. And then the blaming of women, as you say, not only for the rape, but for not speaking up, not
mm-hmm.
speaking up soon enough. When it's like, that game is rigged.
Mm-hmm.
We know if we speak up, it's not going to go well. Okay, so let's, I'd like to take a little,
on the power, thank you, Lady Gaga, for using her power to do something like this. That I really
Yeah.
Hats off.
Mm-hmm. And when I work with women survivors, one of the things for them is to see that women in power have had, the powerful women still have this experience, and it's like, okay, maybe it's not just me. Maybe there's something deeper, something more pervasive that's going on. So we're going to take a little break and go over to the poster board there and just jot down what you think of when we think of rape culture. What are the things that are underlying that makes this continue to happen to women? Not only diverse women, but I was surprised in the video of how many diverse men. There were jocks and geeks, and everybody seemed to think that was okay for them. So let's go over there, if we will, and just jot down everything we can think of when we think of what it is in rape culture that makes this happen. And what is rape culture? Okay?
So, and male entitlement.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. The feeling that, like, a woman owes them something.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, when I hear, and I think about that, and really, we saw that even in just the innocent way with Dar Williams' song. But, you know, it's like that old stereotype of feminists being anti-men. It's like, no, it's just what our culture's view of masculinity makes of men. Mm-hmm. We've got women shaming, women blaming. They're blamed for they do or if they don't. What they wore, if they wore too much or too little. If it was too slutty looking or tease-ish. And of course the response is, it didn't happen. And now guys are saying, now we have to believe everybody, what the world has come to. go figure. Or she lied about it, and really the stats show that women, there are no more false reports of sexual assault than any other crime. Mm-hmm. But the belief is that, again, that blaming of women. She was drinking, so it was her fault. He was drinking, so it wasn't his fault. That's kind of interesting. But really, the fact that rape is really, it's not the crime, it's the weapon. It's a weapon of hatred against women, a weapon that's used, a sexualized weapon. What I want you to think about, though, as we start thinking about rape culture, is that, that I want to challenge the idea of rape culture. It's not just rape. When I worked in battered women's shelter, I worked on violence against women in intimate relationships. People at sexual assault crisis centers worked on that area. The hashtag MeToo movement came about sexual harassment of celebrities in work and power. So I want to challenge the idea, and we're going to do it through music, and you're going to do it through music making, and also through our music listening, but understanding that it's broader than just sexual assault. To look at what is it that it's not just rape, it's everything. There's something underlying much more pervasive. They say 1 in 2 Canadian women will experience male violence of some sort in their life, during their lifetime. 1 in 2, that's huge. So if you haven't, yay, we're lucky. Which is a bit scary, because a lot of people, men and women, think that there's something you do or can do to protect yourself from it. And it may just be more luck than anything. So I don't know if you know this song. The lyrics are there in your song sheet if you want to have a look at it. It's Hunted by Cowboy Junkies. Fingers need a sound, and out of every crevice keeps creeping, spreading out of direction. Anything that struck you in the lyrics?
She stays on well-traveled paths and is always making sure that she doesn't develop patterns. I feel like that's something that every woman feels and is always like alert. Like just in all the lyrics, even like the questioning their safety when they're doing, you know, like daily mundane experiences. And to always, you know, be on the lookout because we're preys. Like we live in a jungle,
mm-hmm.
that. And the pattern thing really struck me because I remember, and to stay on well-traveled paths, because when I was in high school, is it okay that I share a personal experience?
Sure. And I forgot to mention, feel free to share as little or as much as you'd like.
Okay. My father would be worried because the bus would sometimes leave me one block away. I could see the house. It would leave me one block away from my house. And he told me, you know, you go straight home. And if you can, like, don't wear your skirt. Wear like your pants uniform,
mm-hmm.
and you know, wear a big coat so and a ball cap so you look like a guy.
Mm-hmm.
He told me that. Yeah.
Wow. How
so
young were you?
I was just in high school, so like 13, you know, in the 15,
mm-hmm.
and yeah.
Yeah, and it strikes me that again, you as you said that it's part of our daily lives to
mm-hmm.
be careful, to watch out, to wonder if today will be a dangerous day and what we have to do to avoid that.
Yeah, I like the line about the trap lines running up and down Main Street,
mm-hmm.
because a lot of it feels like a trap. You know,
mm-hmm.
you're damned if you do, damned if you don't, blamed mm-hmm. if you do.
Yeah.
So she really illustrated that.
Yeah, and so normalized that, again, and that's part of the so-called rape culture, is that women have to do something to not get raped, rather than saying, let's stop men from raping.
Mm-hmm. She had so many different situations, which was something I found striking because, you know, it can happen in any situation.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was really important that she made that
mm-hmm.
point. Everything from mundane activities to being at work to,
mm-hmm.
you know, being in a new relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Or going out for drinks with friends.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I found that the music really captured the kind of feeling that you can have, like especially that feeling that I think almost every woman has experienced of just like walking home maybe a little bit later
mm-hmm.
and always checking behind you and kind of walking really fast or pretending to be on the phone, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like the music really captured that beyond just the lyrics,
yeah.
In the kind of the movement of it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And even just the title Hunted, it's
mm-hmm.
like, as you said, what you said, prey, you know, we are in danger. And just to constantly have to spend that much time and energy from very young. I remember probably 13 was the first time some guy showed me his junk. It's like I was walking home from high school. He pulled me over. I thought he was asking for directions. It's like, oh, that's a surprise. And yet, you know, at the time, I didn't chalk it up to too much. Oh, creepy old guy. But that happens so often in so many parts of our daily lives. I think would be a surprise to men how much time we have to focus in from how early on.
I think that is something men have trouble understanding, is the aspect of self-consciousness that we're expected to have at every time. You know, and whether it's a, dark person in an alley or not, it's just this idea that you're constantly vigilant about what you look like, where you are, what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's something that we need to communicate to men to help them understand.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Actually, I want to do two things maybe at once, is go over there and now list every single possible overt kinds of violence women experience, and then look at the covert things, like you talked about having to watch how we dress and what's not. And so we'll do two at once, two posters at once, and then the second will be what's the underpinning of all of this. So it's a culture of male violence against women. It's not a culture of just rape. It's all sorts. And again, as professionals, we tend to separate them out as different things. So working with battered women is different than working with rape survivors. But it's not. There's something common that underpins all of it. So let's see if we can go over and pull up some ideas of what that might be.
Okay. Women getting paid less for doing the same jobs, or not getting the jobs at all.
Mm-hmm. So you consider that a covert,
yeah.
You know, put their hand on the woman's back and You know, it's like a bit of a control. It's subtle, it's maybe even sexual, but it, you know, it's normal.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Or that goes along with the like mansplaining and man interruption too.
Yeah.
That,
should I write those on this?
Yeah, maybe that should have gone over there. But
well, no, I just mean that the I meant when that the entitlement goes along
goes,
with that.
Yeah,
because
yeah,
it's because it's kind of feeling like the need to give unsolicited advice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, I
can't finish my sentence.
No, please. Let him go on.
Hey,
calm down a bit here, Kelly. I'm a guy, and I know why these guys do this. The bottom line is this, ladies.
We're talking about
ladies.
The MC.
Girls.
You do it in the casting of the film, not in the casting of the show.
A white man explained diversity to an African American woman.
Various ways, frankly, to silence people to basically say that a man doesn't have a right to talk about certain things.
So, some of the things that explain the mansplaining, why does it happen, or and the bigger picture. For me, when I think about mansplaining, again, it's a guy explaining to a woman what she already knows. So it's not just explaining. It's when, and I think it's the lack of respect for women. So a devaluation that a woman, maybe there's other ideas. Well, why is it that men interrupt women so much? Despite the stereotype that women are the chatty ones. Not convinced over there.
No, I'm convinced. I'm just thinking. On Netflix, there was this documentary on feminism,
mm-hmm.
and the woman saying that when she finally divorced her husband or something, she'd never had a bank account, she'd never had a bank card, she'd never signed a check, she'd never done anything for herself. So there's this idea that women can't do a lot of things because we weren't allowed to for so many centuries and all of that stuff. So, but this is recent. I mean, these were women in the documentary that were still alive, right?
Yeah.
So it's not that long ago that a woman didn't have, if she was married, she didn't have a checkbook and she didn't. So it's like this deep-rooted conception that we need men to do things for
yeah.
us. In some
and
cases
I,
we do, but
And I think, when I think about it, I mean, there's so much change since my mother's era. But on the other hand, every single one of my sisters, when they get in the car with their husband's behind the wheel.
Mm-hmm.
So we seem to, and our social, gender role socialization happens so early on in life before we can think it, we tend to defer to men. Even though there's no laws or no rules anymore, but there's the more subtle things, and sometimes those subtle things are harder to fight. Certainly self-esteem, there's, you know, talk about women's self-esteem, that it plummets when we hit high school, and just keeps getting worse, and men have challenges too, but for women in a culture, we didn't put down on that list, but I would think one of the things really is misogyny,
mm-hmm.
a culture that devalues, we said that, but also really there's a disrespect, almost a hatred of women, it would seem. Some of the other things, male entitlement, we definitely hit upon. Objectification, one of you mentioned objectification of women, I think, but also goes with the conflation of sexual, women being sexual bodies for men, but also the confusion between sexuality and sexual violence. Sometimes they're seen as the same when they can be quite different. I was struck when 50 Shades of Grey, and they were talking about, oh, this new radical revolutionary book for women. I was like, yeah, I want to hear about it. Let me find out. And they say, oh, it's a man abusing a woman. It's like, oh, tale as old as time. If she'd been the dominatrix, that might have been a different story. The last one on the list, internalization by women. That's a hard one.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it's very subtle, but I go to get my doctorate so that I'll be respected in the hospitals. I didn't respect myself enough. I didn't ever feel quite confident enough. Can you think of other experiences if you had of internalizing, where you sort of come to?
One that comes to mind in that same kind of idea, mm-hmm. is the imposter syndrome, that when you're in a profession that you're not qualified enough to be there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, even if you are.
Yeah. And I don't want to get into women blaming. It's like it's all our fault because we don't have confidence. My God, if we. It's not surprising we don't have confidence in a culture that views women's value as only their physical looks and then makes it impossible to match the look that we're supposed to have. Yikes. Other people, other experiences of internalizing?
I think we internalize a lot of appearance ideals, mm-hmm. saying. So you see women shaming other women for having hairy legs or not having the right haircut, not dressing right, and
mm-hmm.
that's where I see that a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, like, when I was growing up, especially in high school, like, I'd always straighten my hair, and that's something, like, and that was just, like, you know, straight hair was just, like, the norm, and everyone would always compliment me when I had my hair straight,
mm-hmm.
Women and men, and, like, it took a lot of time to embrace, like, curly hair is part of my cultural identity, and I should embrace that. And that was something that, like, and I internalized, like, no, like, straight hair is what's pretty, and I had internalized that for a long time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the ideal is, the woman's body ideal is so restrictive and so
mm-hmm.
not diverse. But it's really even impossible no matter who you are.
Mm-hmm.
The skinniness that, I certainly have felt the pressure about weight and body image. And now since I actually stopped dyeing my hair, I surprised myself about my ageist attitudes. It's like, what? It's like, oh yeah, it's like I'm old now. It's like, oh, wait a minute. So that youthful, young, thin, slim body, that's important. So just a reminder, as we're talking about male violence against women, that it affects all women, and women who think they're not affected may be part of the internalization of her culture to accept as normal. Because I still remember when I was in Florida and this woman got raped in a bar, and I went the next day to the campus, and the staff were saying, well, you know, she asked for it. She was there by herself, and she wasn't dressed properly. So it's not only men that might think that women are asking for it. Women might think that women are asking for it, too, because we think about what we learn about being men and women, about boys and girls. We learn by very strong opinions by age of 3. And so that's long before we begin to start questioning, being critical. So it affects all women, even if all women don't think it does. But it all affects women differently, depending on their social location. So we've seen with the hashtag MeToo, a lot of powerful women celebrities, who may not have been powerful at the time, but they were still celebrities. But women in greater poverty are certainly much more impacted, and might simply not be able to speak up because they'll lose their job, or not be able to take care of their children and all those things. So we have to think about that. All of this, then, I want you to think about that rape culture is a great catchy term, and it gets people's attention, but it dismisses the interconnection of all the forms of violence, the obvious ones and the less obvious ones. And so that's what might be helpful to think about as we think about how we're going to change a culture. We can't just, even though, like, when you think about consent, you know, there's efforts to educate men about what consent is. I'm guessing there's some guys who may have been confused, but I'm guessing there's some guys who just didn't give a hoot. They knew they didn't have consent, like the guy putting a drug in a drink, and didn't care. And that goes back to that male entitlement. But also, all of these underpinnings, our attitudes about men and women, boys and girls, are sort of underpinning it, all of it.